Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is once again Todd Wilkins' guest on Issues, Etc. They're discussing the growing controversy surrounding Michael LaCour's recent study on genderless marriage. Science Journal has retracted the study in light of all sorts of dishonesty that has surfaced about how it was conducted. They also discussed Dr. J's recent presentation at UC Santa Barbara that started off with a noisy protest.
The family is the singular most important institution in society. It existed before government.
This is something that happens to me all the time. I am a housewife. That is my job. And people always want to know, oh, that's nice, and what else do you do?
Joel's church, as magnificent as the Houston Convex Center is, would pale in comparison to the temple that Solomon built. Joel only has one wife. I think Solomon had around 1,000. So Solomon out-Osteen's Osteen, by far.
It was cross before glory for him. And as that was true for him, it's going to be true for us.
Former evangelicals on track to be Lutheran pastors by attending Concordia Theological Seminary in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Love, Issues, Etc.
You can't believe everything you read, can you? Now, there are levels of that. We know that if you go on the internet, you can't believe everything you read there. Who does? If you do, sorry for you. The newspaper. We've all learned by hard experience that not everything that appears in so-called hard journalism is in fact true. But the scientific journal is supposed to be one of the last holdouts of this is proven true. This research has not only been done properly, its method has been vetted, but all of the conclusions drawn therefrom also have been vetted carefully by peers before it ever went into print. Now, that is not necessarily true of research nowadays. And an example of it we're going to be talking about here with Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. Serious doubts raised about a study of gay canvassers. And it has not only researchers, but also the advocates of same-sex marriage scratching their heads. We'll be talking about that flawed study on same-sex marriage activism here on this Thursday afternoon, May the 28th. Welcome back to Issues, Etc. I'm Todd Wilkin. Thanks for tuning us in. Joining us to talk about a flawed study on same-sex marriage activism, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris. She's founding president of the Ruth Institute based in San Marcos, California. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason Universities, and she's author of the books Smart Sex and Love in Economics. Jennifer, welcome back.
Hi, Todd. Thanks for having me.
Well, I understand from something I saw on social media, you had a very interesting speaking engagement at UC Santa Barbara. Tell us about what happened there before we get into our subject.
Oh, well, yes, it was great. Actually, I was invited to be the inaugural speaker for the Love and Fidelity Network chapter at UC Santa Barbara. And so I went up there and the students had announced that I was going to be speaking and my title would be Same-Sex Marriage, Why Not? And evidently some people on campus at first thought that that was going to be a pro-gay marriage event because they interpreted they misinterpreted the title of the talk. I must admit that's never happened to me before, that people were unsure about my position. But anyway, they had a bit of back and forth with the administration about whether they were going to have to pay for security and whether they were going to have to pay for the use of the PowerPoint and the microphone. It just kind of certain amount of harassment the students endured. Yes, it's a brand new student club, you know, and they're just giving them a hard time. Anyway, I got there, and about 20 protesters marched into the room where I was speaking and sat down. They were all in, you could tell they were together because they were all in matching shirts that said on the back, "We do recruit." And they were holding up signs which were really quite vulgar, which people can see on my Facebook page. If you go to Jennifer Roback Morse PhD Facebook page, you can see some of those signs. I'm not going to mention them on the air. But as soon as I was introduced, these students stood up, turned their backs to me, and started this chant that went on for, I don't know, 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. Chant didn't seem to have anything to do with anything. It's some power to the people thing, some kind of leftist I don't know why they came up with that, but they just chanted, you know. So I got up and I went out to where they were. I left the podium and went down into the seats, you know, and stood there so I could face them and started trying to engage them. And, you know, they wouldn't have any part of that. They continued their chant. They all marched out, and then they never came back, you know. So, you know, everybody is, we're all there in the room thinking, well, gee, what just happened? So I just went ahead and did my speech, you know, 45-minute speech on how genderless marriage will create genderless parenting and how that will create structural injustices to children. And then we had another 45 minutes of discussion and conversation with people all across the spectrum who were in attendance at the event. And no disruption, no problem whatsoever. And at some, you know, lots of challenging questions. So not everybody was on board with what I was saying, but it was very constructive, Todd. It was very civil discussion. And at one point in the conversation, I had occasion to say, you know, this discussion about the definition of marriage, there's been a lot of noise about it, but not necessarily engagement with the issues. And I said, I think all of you have learned something here tonight, or thought, you know, been prompted to think about things you didn't know. And they, you know, they all kind of nodded in agreement. And I said, what happened was a perfect metaphor or microcosm of what has happened in the larger culture. A bunch of people came in here, made noise, and walked out before there was any kind of discussion. And for the handful of people who stayed for the discussion, we learned a lot. But the noisemakers have really dominated the public airwaves far too much. And so on net, I would have to say it was a big win for free speech and civil discourse and for the defense of marriage, for sure. It was a big win.
Well, and I think the thing that I find telling about your response here is that you haven't once said, well, these people were terrible, awful, rude people. They have no right to disrupt my precious presentation. They had a right to be there, to hold their signs and do all of those things. They just didn't want to engage in any conversation with you about this.
It was most interesting. You know, as people came into the room, I was going through the audience, shaking hands and welcoming people and thanking them for coming, you know, and which I routinely do for my presentations. You know, I always try to do that. And not one of those kids would shake my hand. You know, they looked at me. I don't know what they thought. I said, you guys, I don't have cooties. It'll be okay, you know. But not one of them would shake my hand, you know. So they really literally would not engage with anything. And I don't want to judge them. I don't know what their problem is, whether they don't want to engage it, whether they have something else in their minds. I don't know. But if you look at the signs that these kids were carrying, and some of them have been reported in the media, and some of them are on my page, as I mentioned. These are really kind of troubling signs, you know. These are not jolly, happy people here confronting us. And one of my themes, Todd, was that the sexual revolution has hurt people, and the people who have been harmed by earlier rounds of the sexual revolution, such as divorce, children of divorce, have been gravely wounded. And who was there for them? Nobody was ever there for them. And who's going to be there for the people who are harmed from the next round of the sexual revolution? Who's ever going to admit that there were any problems, you know, when all you get is noisemaking like this and no real engagement? So I think the students in the audience were at least moved by that. Even if they don't 100% agree with me, I think they saw the point in why that needs to be said.
Let's turn to the subject of this study on same-sex marriage activism. It swirled around voters, their thoughts on California's Prop 8. Refresh our memory. What was the issue, and what were the voters being asked to do?
The study purported to say that if you went around and canvassed voters who had voted against, who had voted in favor of Prop 8, and you continue to engage with them, would that somehow change their opinion over time? Because there's a lot of interest among the gay activist community to find out what they could do to do better after they lost Prop 8. So this young student from UCLA purported to do a study where he purported to show that if it was a gay canvasser going through the neighborhood, talking to people, somehow engaging people about the issue, that people would be more likely to change their minds and be more likely to support the redefinition of marriage if it was a gay canvasser talking to them. So that's what the study purported to do, but it's come out now that the study didn't really do that.
So essentially, there was follow-up effort after Prop 8 passed in California that would have defined marriage constitutionally as a one man and one woman. And the gay activists at the time are saying, look, we want to know how we can, in the grassroots way, sway voters who voted for Prop 8. And apparently the researcher can't produce the data.
Right. He can't produce the data. The funders that he said he had a number of funders on board to pay for the research. Those funders are saying, we never heard of this guy. No, we didn't give him money. He claimed that he paid the respondents to participate in the study because it was going to be a longitudinal study, going back to the same people multiple times. He claimed that he was going to pay them, and that is why they continued to participate in the study. Turned out he didn't pay them. Which makes sense, because if he didn't really have the money for the funders, I don't know what he would be paying them with. And in fact, the thing came to light when another group of researchers tried to replicate his findings, and they couldn't get anything like the response rate that he got. He got like 12% of the respondents to come back and continue to participate, and they were getting like 3%. And they're like, what? We must be doing something wrong. And they were the ones, in fact, who discovered that something was wrong, and that's what triggered the whole sequence of events to look into it more closely to see what is the data, what did he actually do. But by this time, the article had been published on Science and had garnered a lot of very favorable attention, a lot of enthusiasm, because people thought, well, gee, this is great. If this study says all we have to do is send gay canvassers out there, that will improve our success rate. And so it's obvious that this is what we need to do. But if that's not true, then, kind of made-up result isn't really going to help your political strategy very much, I wouldn't think. But in any case, that's how it came to light, Todd, is that somebody tried to replicate it and couldn't replicate even the most basic thing of getting a comparable response rate. And that clued people into the fact there must be something wrong here.
Okay, this highlights two things. I'd like you to address both of them, if you would. First of all, is there other flawed research being done in the name of the advocacy of same-sex marriage that you know of?
Oh, my goodness, Todd, I've said this for a long time. Most of the studies that purport to show no difference between same-sex parents and heterosexual married parents, most of those studies are flawed. And that's been, I think everybody in the field knows that that's true. They've been flawed by small sample sizes, by over-interpretation, drawing conclusions that were not warranted from the unrepresentative nature of the samples. And in fact, a lot of those studies were done by advocates and were paid for by advocacy organizations. So many of the criticisms that are leveled at, for example, Mark Ragnaris, apply in spades and to a far greater extent to some of the studies, the earlier studies and even the ongoing studies that purport to show there's no difference between same-sex couples as parents and others.
The other thing highlighted by this that I'd like you to address, and you have before, and that is I think I'll just for the speculate about motives here, that the researcher who's kind of cooked up these conclusions wanted to show that this is a grassroots thing, that the support for same-sex marriage has bubbled up from the bottom, and if we do a better job of kind of working up the bubbles, it will become a widespread grassroots effort. How has same-sex marriage actually found its way into the legal code of the United States state by state? Has it been, in fact, at the average voter, grassroots?
Well, that's a very interesting question that you asked, because by and large, it has not been a grassroots movement. By and large, there's been a lot of, kind of manipulation of public opinion, a lot of expensive media presence in favor of the redefinition of marriage. And, you know, we can just look to the most recent election in Ireland, where millions of dollars crossed the pond from pro-gay American foundations being spent in Ireland to influence an Irish election, an election in another country. You know, that's not a grassroots movement. And so, whatever the election results are over there, it doesn't prove what you think it wants to prove, you know. And I think you may be right that the reason people were enthused about this this study that's been proven to be fraudulent, the reason they were enthused about the results is it made it look like all you needed to do was to put an attractive gay face out there, talk to people enough, and incidentally give jobs to a lot of young, attractive gay men and lesbian women. You know, it's now a jobs program. But that's all you'd need to do, and that would create this, you know, kind of spontaneous demand. Now, it might be that it seems intuitive that, in fact, if you know somebody who's gay, that's a persuasive argument. I mean, that's probably has some foundation to it. But what I can't understand is why would you go to so much trouble to fake a study? I mean, making stuff up is not research. It's just making stuff up. And I would think if I were trying to plot my next move and figure out what my good strategy was going to be to spend movement resources on, I would think I want to know the truth about what actually persuades people. I wouldn't think that something made up would be particularly helpful to people who are actually trying to get something done. So, you know, this young guy, I guess, was trying to make a name for himself, and he did. It turns out not a very good name for himself. But I'm a little bit disturbed that the, shall we call them the grown-ups or the more establishment-type people, took the bait so readily to believe what they wanted to believe rather than looking more closely at the results themselves and the methodology itself.
Before we let you go, tell us about your latest book, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims.
Well, yes, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims is a collection of essays that I've written over the last few years, and it deals with just this kind of theme that the sexual revolution has claimed many victims that have never been properly acknowledged or supported. And we have on the cover of that book, we have an image of Marilyn Monroe. And we think Marilyn Monroe is a great metaphor or a great representative of the concept of the sexual revolution and its victims, because on the one hand, she is to this day an iconic image of glamour and beauty and excitement and sex appeal. But we know that her life was really quite miserable, that she died at an early age from an overdose of drugs, which I don't think been established whether it was suicide or something else, you know. She was exploited by men. She was not very nice to a lot of people in her life. And according to her biographer, Norman Mailer, she had 12 abortions by the time she was 29 years old. So Marilyn Monroe in her life is an image for the way in which the sexual revolution is promoted as this wonderful thing, but all the problems are airbrushed out of that beautiful, attractive image. And what I'm trying to do in this book, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims, is to call attention to the fact that every single phase of the sexual revolution has claimed victims, and no one has ever taken responsibility for the harms that the sexual revolution has caused to people.
Folks, you can find out more about the sexual revolution and its victims at issuesetc.org. Click Listen on Demand. Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse is founding president of the Ruth Institute based in San Marcos, California. She taught economics for 15 years at Yale and George Mason universities, and she's author of the book Smart Sex, Love and Economics, and her latest, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. Jennifer, thank you very much for being our guest.
You're very welcome, Todd. Thank you.
You've just been listening to Dr. James Todd Wilkin discussing Michael LaCour's recent flawed study on genderless marriage, science's retraction of its publication, research, advocacy, public discourse, and genderless marriage on Issues, etc. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.